One day in August 1939, gifted singer Solomon Linda was in a recording session at Gallo Recording Studios accompanied by his vocal group, The Evening Birds. He sings his composition, Mbube, which after being recorded, was cut with tiny grooves into a rotating block of beeswax, which was taken to England and transformed into a disc that contained the best-known African melody in the world. In the southeast of Africa, precisely in Mzinga, municipality of KwaZulu-Natal, South Africa, a certain Solomon Tsili, otherwise called Solomon Popili Linda, was born in 1909. Shortly after Linda's birth, the British colony of Natal ceased to exist. A few years later, the young Anrangi Solomon studied at Gordon Memorial School, where he learned Western musical culture, anthems, and participated in choral competitions. The institution was the only one at the time that allowed education to blacks. Solomon had spent most of his youth with his grandmother in Makasini raising cattle. He knew the musical traditions of Amahubo and Izingo Mazamchato, wedding songs. In the early 1930s, Solomon Linda moved to Johannesburg, and was employed at the Mayu Mayu furniture shop by his colleagues from Pomeroy, Boy C.B. Yaw and Gideon Kizi. However, 2 years later in 1933 he was employed at the Carlton Hotel, located in the center of Johannesburg. At that time, in 1931, he joined the Evening Birds Choir, directed by his uncle Solomon and Ahmed Ondo. Within this group, he sang in singing competitions as well as private parties, including weddings. The Evening Birds broke up in 1933. The members now concentrated on their secondary duties. However, Solomon would form another vocal group which would retain the name Evening Bird. Alongside him are Gilbert Madondo, alto singer, Boy C.B. Yeah, tenorist, and Gideon Kizi, Samuel Mlajani and Owen Sick Hackhain as basses. Solomon Linda obviously had the role of lead singer soprano. The group evolved from performances at weddings to choir competitions. Booking the Evening Birds for a show cost 10 shillings. Linda's musical popularity grew with the Evening Birds, who performed a very cool urban act that wears striped suits, bowler hats, and dandy two-tone shoes. They were considered the best singers and were invincible in the previously mentioned choir competitions. Solomon Linda and the Evening Birds then pioneered a new style of music, the name of which was yet to be established. Solomon Linda was the Elvis Presley of his time and place, a shy, gangly 30-year-old, so tall that he had to stoop as he passed through doorways. In 1938, the Evening Birds were spotted by talent scout and singer Griffiths Matsiloa. The latter takes Solomon and his troupe to Gallo Recording Studios, where they record many songs, including original compositions by Linda but also traditional songs. In the same year, their first single was released, featuring Makasini and Foka Linda, recorded during the first session of Solomon Linda and the Evening Bird. Foka Linda, in English Son of Linda, is a presentation of the members of the group. Solomon Linda became one of the most popular singers on the South African music scene. He often published several records throughout 1938 and was in great demand for shows, competitions and performances, especially in the Bantu Sport Hall. In the second session of the Evening Birds, which took place in August of 1939, about 10 songs are recorded, including Mbube. Mbube has been recorded 3 times. The first take was good, the second a little better. Matsiloa looked into the corridor, dragooned Emily Matsiloa, a pianist, Willie Gumede, a banjo player, a guitar player, and tried again. The third will be the special. It happens to sound the same as the earlier recordings, but around the 20th second of minute 2, just before the song ends, Solomon Linda improvises a catchy 12-note melody. After the session is over, Solomon and his colleagues leave the studio. They don't know, but they had just recorded one of the most popular songs on the continent, the melody of which will be a multi-million dollar fetching gem. Griffiths Matsiloa must have realized he had captured something special, because that piece of beeswax was shipped all the way to England and returned as 10-inch 78 RPM records, which were put on sale in September of 1939, just as Hitler was invading Poland. As soon as Mbube was released, the musical genre launched by Linda and the Evening Birds was called Mbube, and also He Seeketh a Miaya, derived from the cry Kathosam Fana, in English Tip Toe Guys. By 1948, Mbube had sold in the region of 100,000 copies, becoming the first African record to achieve that amount of sales, and Solomon Linda remained the undefeated and invincible champion of hostelry singing competitions and a superstar in the world of Zulu migrants. In the following years, Solomon and the Evening Birds continued session by session until the late 1940s. 1954 was the release date of Solomon Linda's last known single. In 1948, Solomon married her girlfriend, Regina, and the Evening Birds eventually disbanded. Despite this, Solomon kept singing and performing. Meanwhile, in 1949, musicologist Alan Lomax found the disc containing Mbube and a lot of African discs shipped to New York. Impressed by the performance of the singers, he did not hesitate to introduce the song to his friend Pete Seeger, folk singer and ex-soldier. Equally impressed, he takes a piece of paper and transcribes the song note by note and adapts Mbube to "Wimbwe," a misspelling of the original chorus "Vimbube," meaning, "You are a lion." He recorded a first version in 1949, and again in 1951 with his group, the Weavers.
Basses and altos and tenors all joining in. It's not a very difficult part, but here I am all by myself, and frankly, I can't sing it very well by myself. But so I'm going to give you the parts, and if you can remember how they go, you just keep on singing them right through the song, over and over. First of all, the low voices, they sing like this. Hey, up, oh, Wimbwe. Wimbwe, Wimbwe. Try it again. Hey, yup. Wimbwe, Wimbwe, Wimbwe. Now, if that's too low for some of you, as it's almost too low for me, you can take the high part that goes. Wimbwe, 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 Wimbwe. Try it again. Wimbwe, 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 Wimbwe. Now put them all together. Basses. Hey, yep. Wimbwe, Wimbwe, Wimbwe. Hey, yep. Wimbwe. I'll add the high part. Over, run over.
Solomon Linda was uncredited. Instead, a certain Paul Campbell was credited as the adapter of Mbube, which was credited as a traditional song. Paul Campbell was a nom de plume, used by the weavers to obtain royalties from their adaptations of traditional songs. Much later, Pete Seeger claimed to have told the label managers to send a $1,000 check for Solomon Linda after discovering that he was a real Mbube composer. But Linda had not received it. On a certain day in April 1952, after VYIMBVBE became infamous, Solomon Linda, who had worked as a record packer at Gallaudet since 1939, was called by his bosses, who asked him to sign a paper. As Linda could neither read nor write, he did not know what was written. Unknowingly, Solomon Linda sells the entire copyright of Mbube to the Gallaudet label. It is suspected that Linda's signature was forged, as someone who cannot read or write would use a fingerprint as a signature, while in the it was written Solomon Linda as a signature. During a performance in 1959, Solomon Linda collapsed on the podium. Later, he was diagnosed with kidney failure. His family suspected that Linda was bewitched by his detractors, also singers. He was frequently in and out from hospitals, but no solution was found. VYIMBVBE reached Billboard's top 10, and became a staple of the Weavers' live repertoire, achieving further exposure on their best-selling The Weavers at Carnegie Hall LP album, recorded in 1955 and issued in 1957. The song was also covered extensively by other folk revival groups such as the Kingston Trio, and Exotica singer Emma Sumac. However, Miriam Makeba in 1960, recorded the same song as Mbube, with the writing credit given to Jay Linda. In May of 1961, two producers, Hugo Peretti and Luigi Creator, hired lyricist and musician George David Wise to write the lyrics for a pop music arrangement of VYIMBVBE. It was for the B-side of a single called Tina, sung by teen doo wop band The Tokens. Linda's melody was assigned to the lyrics.
In the jungle, the mighty jungle, the lion sleeps tonight. In the jungle, the quiet jungle, the lion sleeps tonight.
The Lion Sleeps Tonight, released in November 1961, skyrocketed to number one on the Billboard Hot 100. It was then certified gold on January 9, 1962, 8 months before Solomon Linda's death, precisely on September 8, 1962. Before his death, he listened to a few covers of Mbube, including that of The Tokens, and liked them. Solomon Linda then leaves a legacy, the Mbube genre, also called Hisika Thamiaya, whose continuity is carried by several artists including Ladysmith Black Mambazo and Malathini. In 2000, South African journalist Ryan Milan wrote a feature article for the magazine Rolling Stone, describing Linda's story and estimating that the song had earned $15 million for its use in The Lion King alone. Milan and the South African filmmaker Francois Verster cooperated to make a television documentary called The Lion's Trail that tells Solomon Linda's story, and which was screened by PBS. In 2004, with the backing of the South African government and Gallo Records, Linda's descendants in South Africa sued the Walt Disney Company for its use in the Lion King movie and stage musical without paying royalties to them. In February 2006, Linda's estate attained a legal settlement with Abilene Music Company, which had the worldwide rights and had licensed the song to Disney. This settlement applies to worldwide rights, not just South African, since 1987. The proceeds of the settlement were placed into a trust to be administered by SA Music Rights CEO Nick Motsatsi. A trial was scheduled to start on February 21, 2006, but just before the trial, a settlement was reached between Linda's estate, Disney and Abilene Music Company, the true defendant of the litigation, who had granted an indemnity to Disney when it licensed use of The Lion Sleeps Tonight and The Lion King. Long live to the one and only Lion King, Solomon, Popoli, Linda.